Hello, welcome. It's time for Atomic Radio Hour, the post nuclear podcast. I'm your host, Vince. This is Atomic Radio Hour. Like I said, the post nuclear podcast. We got a full house tonight. Hello, everybody. While this is being recorded live, if you like the show, check out the Patreon, the $10 tier. You can watch these episodes get recorded live as well. My name is Vince. This is a Lucy McLean Stan account. There's nothing that's ever going to change that. Okay? We stand for Prim Slim and we kneel for Lucy McLean in my house. Welcome to the show. How are you guys? A lot of fun things to talk about tonight. First of which, I need to issue an apology. I was wrong. I was scared, and I was alone, and I acted alone, and my actions are my own. I was really wrong about Fallout 4, and I really need to apologize. Fallout 4 and I are kind of like old lovers. We really love it. We're kind of like the alpha couple from the Mountain Goats. Except, Fallout 4 has been nothing but good to me, and I've just refused to love it as much as I feel like it deserves to be loved. The next gen update came out, and you're probably playing it. You might be playing it and listening to this at the exact same time. That's my target demo, homie. And I've been playing it. And I love it. And I don't know what has changed. I have an idea what has changed, but I'm really, really enjoying it. And I know this is the big meme, so everybody get ready. Everybody hold on to those horses. And I know there's always, I think it's Lamp, like every time I say this, comment something about this. The voiced protagonist is not bothering me all that much. I know. Character development? Huh? What? I don't know why it's not bothering me. I'm playing the game and I'm really enjoying it. I'm doing all the free mods, the DLC mods that they put out. The Enclave stuff is cool. I've made like a power armor knight. Like, I've really gone heavy into the power armor. I've named myself Horrigan. I wanted to make something that I originally named myself Lil Horrigan, but I would see Lil all the time and it really bothered me. So I just named it Horrigan. And like, I'm doing the Enclave quests and one of them is like Operation Takedown Horrigan. And I was like, no, they love me. I'm loving it. Like, I'm genuinely having a good time. The base building in Fallout 4 is so good. Like, I'm upset that I messed around with it in Fallout 4, but the power armor feels right, especially just after watching the show. I'm sorry, Fallout 4. I love you. I really do. And it's a good game. And I've always stood by that it was a good game. I never said that it wasn't a good game. There's little things about it that bother me. And one of my biggest things was that my vault suit was too clean. And now there's an option to just make it dirty. And I was like, all right, that bumps it up a point. Like, as dumb as it is, there we go. And now we're back to where we should be. If you've been listening to this show since the start of this show, you know what I've said about Fallout 4. And as of late, turns out I kind of love her. Oh, except for like some of the quests don't work. The new quests that they put in, like the makeshift weapons, I can't get. And I don't know what that's about. I've been seeing people can't do them. I'm expecting a fix in a couple days. Like, they're doing a huge update on Starfield, and as Starfield being a game that I played for like 30 hours and put down, and then was like, maybe I'll go back one day once like the DLC comes out and some other stuff. It seems like they're putting a lot of stuff in it to make it like more fun. And I already had a decent time with it, but the fact that they're putting in like a car so I can like vroom vroom all around is neat. So like, maybe we'll get a big update for the update that had come out that fixes a lot of things. Cause you know, the argument of, oh, it broke all my mods, I don't feel like is a fair argument because, you know, is a game really fun if you have to mod it? Do you really enjoy the game or do you enjoy the mods? Which is my whole argument. And that's not to say people who download like Fallout London or Miami or any of the other story-based mods that are coming out. I don't know. Like, that doesn't mean anything about that. It's just one of those, like, you know, just play the game as it is. Maybe mod it later on, but, like, I don't know. I'm not one for mods. Simple as that. Captain Lennox even just says in the chat, the update came at a perfect time for me. I've been doing a revisit by playing on my newish console. Been going for a juggernaut build. I think we're kind of doing the same thing. And I've been enjoying it so far, but I forgot just how many areas have supers in them. To be fair, I don't know, like, the super mutants I know is like a big thing. Like, oh, how come there's so many super mutants? And I get that. But also, I like just started. Pretty much. I've been doing my best to stay away from the story so I can go do stuff. So I can just level. And then once I hit like level 20, I'm going to start doing DLC. And I'm going to save Nuka World for the end because I remember really liking Nuka World. But, pause. The Super Mutant Hounds are very hard. They just always were. And I don't understand why. The game's also harder than I remember. But I'm also doing like a melee build. So I'm just in power armor, bopping MFs in the MF and face. And I really enjoy it. I really, really like it. We're going to stop talking about Fallout 4 in just a second. There's one point I just want to point out. I messaged a friend about this because I was having a good time with it. And I was like, hey, I think I might love Fallout 4. And in the exchange back and forth, we talked about like the game. And there's my buddy at work that I talk to about Fallout a lot. And I was like, I don't know if I'm just not depressed anymore, or if I'm just not a cynical cunt anymore. Either way, I am fucking loving this game. And like 16, 17, 18, 19 year old me, when the game came out, would be like, ooh, really? We've changed. We've changed for the better. All right, now we're gonna stop talking about Fallout 4. We're gonna talk about more new Fallout stuff. So I don't have to tell you, you don't have to tell me, we all know. But this is a podcast, so I have to explain things. Recently, Todd Howard was in an IGN interview. And I know, IGN. But this is written by Kate Bailey. Oh my god, IGN hired somebody with a name that isn't difficult to pronounce and makes me look bad. Holy shit. This is a really, really, really quick little article. I'm only going to read a few snippets out of... It just says that Fallout TV series has topped 65 million viewers. If I remember correctly, and I could be wrong when I say this, it has reached 1.2 billion views. In a new interview with Kinda Funny Games director Todd Howard appeared to tease two unannounced Fallout projects, saying, "We look at what we're doing with the Fallout franchise, and then we say, do we still feel good about it? I can't reveal it now, but here's our runway for Fallout as a franchise." He continued, "When is season 2 happening? What are we doing on mobile? What are we doing in 76? What are we doing with this thing? What are we doing with the other thing? And when are these things landing? And again, if I could snap my fingers and have them all be out and ready, I would. But the main thing is, how do we deliver these at a high quality level? That is always important." One of the things that may have been talked about that Todd may be alluding to is a Fallout 3 remaster that was revealed in documents that was published by the Federal Trade Commission. I talked about it a while ago. It's one of my like favorite thumbnails ever on YouTube, because it's me like and it just makes me laugh every time I see it, because I'll just be scrolling through and I see, and it's just me making a stupid face. But we could be getting that. I don't think that there's two things that were announced, honestly. I think that there are... I don't think that they're talking about multiple things. There's another thing. I wasn't going to reference it, but I think it's pertinent for this. I believe it was kind of funny. There was an interview. Kyle sent me this clip. I watched like half of it. That they were like, "How come Bethesda hates New Vegas?" And Todd, I was like, "We don't hate New Vegas. Let me find it. Hold on, let me just find it, because we're talking about it." While I find that, the point I'm getting at is that I don't think that they're saying we're going to be getting a Fallout game anytime soon. I don't think they're saying that they're working on any sort of a project. What I think that they're saying is that people love this thing and they're trying to take care of it. They're trying to make sure that everybody feels happy with the products that they are being given and everybody understands the importance of what they are doing. I would love to see another studio. I mean, In Exile works with Microsoft if they're not owned by them. Obsidian is now owned by Microsoft. And the team that made New Vegas is not the team that works at Obsidian right now. But I think Tim Cain is like kind of working there in some capacity. And Tim Kaine has said that he has a script for Fallout that if anything ever happened, like, he's never told anybody it, but, like, if the game were to come out, he'd be like, wow, I wrote the exact same thing. So here is the quote. Todd Howard on Bethesda hating New Vegas discourse. That game, that's a game that we, Bethesda, in parentheses, published. New Vegas is a very important game to us and to the fans that we love. And if anything, the TV show leans into the events of New Vegas. We gotta stop saying shit as a community, as a whole. We gotta stop saying shit and assuming it's correct. I'm guilty of this myself. If I had a nickel for every time I saw somebody thought something went one way, turns out it went the other, I would be a very rich man. It's human to do it. I don't understand why New Vegas fans, or just Fallout fans, let's stop putting people in the margins. I don't understand why we're all so ready to hate. We're at a time where my favorite thing, I'm assuming it's one of yours or something you vehemently enjoy, is doing the best that it's ever done. This thing came out in the 90s, had a small following. Second one came out in the 90s, had a little bigger of a following. Nobody heard about it again, except for some side projects, which we're not really sure if they're canon, but they seem fun. Until 08, and it just has been a slow snowball up until we are where we are currently. And it's a beautiful time to be a fan. I really, really wish that we would get something. I've said this before, I'll say it again. There's a Mr. Matty Plays video where he says, get some people, get some devs, make a studio that is just focused on Fallout stuff and give us what we need. It sucks that Fallout next year, Fallout 4 is 9 years old as of this recording. And I'm recording this on May 1st, 2024 in the year of your Lord. The game came out right before my birthday. It was like November 11th or November 10th. November 9th, like around that area of 2015. I was like just getting out of school. Like I was ready to get out of school. If I wasn't already, I don't remember. Time's dumb. No, was I? When I graduate, June 2015? June-ish? April, May, June, something like that. So yeah, I was like fresh out of high school, working. And here's Fallout 4. There is a real chance we are not seeing Fallout 4 until, or excuse me, Fallout 5 until the 30s, and I keep saying this. Anyway, I want to talk about this week's lore, and I got to thank some people. We got to talk about some fine folks at home. If you like the show, consider checking out the links in the description below. Not just the Discord, not just my Twitter, not just the Redbubble where you can get some merch, but the Patreon. There are a few folks that I have to thank. A lot of them are here tonight. On screen now should be some names. These are people that believe in the show, that like the program, that want to see the program get bigger and better. And there's some cool perks when you become part of the Patreon. So starting at the top, I have to thank the OG Noah. Thank you, Noah. After Noah, I have to thank Marcus, who is here tonight. Thank you, Marcus. After Marcus, I have to thank Mellow Millhouse. Thank you to Mellow Millhouse. After Mellow Millhouse, I have to thank Captain Lennox. Thank you to Captain Lennox again, who is here tonight live. And last but certainly not least, the newest of newcomers to the show, I have to thank Danish Hound Dog again, who is with us, coming to us all the way from the Netherlands. Is it proper to call it the Netherlands where you are from, sir? I do not want to be insensitive. No, it is not proper. Where are you coming to us live from so I don't seem like a dick? That's another country. My geography sucks. My geography is awful. And I thought I was really good at geography. Turns out I'm not. Denmark! Coming to us all the way from Denmark. I apologize. Like I said, my geography am bad. I feel really bad about this. I'm really sorry. Thank you to everybody who's here tonight. Thank you to everyone who supports on Patreon. Thank you to anybody who just watches this and shows it to their friends or share me on Reddit, please. Please share me on Reddit. Trying to go to the next Fallout Live event. Trying to work from home. Trying to do this full time. Trying to make YouTube stuff. Trying to fulfill the inner creativity inside of me. I love you. Enjoy the lore. Lore. Fallout lore. Great time to be a Fallout fan. A lot of really interesting characters, locations, quests, things are currently happening. One of the big ones is the show. Obviously, I am absolutely loving all of the new lore that we are getting from the Fallout show, from Fallout on Prime. And I'm really, really captured by the three main antagonists. And last week, I had asked the Patreon what they wanted to hear. So it was a three-way poll. If you guys at home want in on it, check out the Patreon. Just putting it out there now. But I put a three-way poll that was the Ghoul, which we did last week, Lucy, and Maximus. And since the Ghoul was picked, this means this week was either Lucy or Maximus. So if you'd like to hear any lore, and I mean any lore whatsoever from the Fallout franchise, consider checking out the Patreon, where your voice is heard every week. And if you like the show, you could be part of the live recording, like I have a couple of fellas here tonight. And by way of the Ghoulman Entertainment Patreon, I bring you the lore on everybody's new favorite vault dweller, Lucy McLean. What can we say about Lucy McLean that the internet hasn't already said? I think she's captured both our hearts and our minds, but there's a few things that I think we could kind of boil her down to. Kind-hearted, incredibly likable, courageous, strong, absolutely brainwashed by Vault Tech. There's a lot of depth in Lucy. There's a lot that I'm ready to see. And the weirdest thing about covering these characters as the show is coming out, it's not like when a game comes out. Fallout 5 comes out, I get a month with the game and I can start covering it because I've played these stories. I understand these characters better than I would have if I just got to watch them for maybe 8 hours. Lucy's played by Ella Purnell, and I didn't see this on... I get all my lore off of Fallout.Fandom.com, the Nukepedia, if you will, along with watching and playing along with my favorite franchise. And what I found was her special stats based on Fallout Shelter, the app, the mobile game. Her special is a 4 strength, 7 perception, 6 endurance, 5 charisma, 6 intelligence, 5 agility, and 7 luck, which I think is really, really fitting for her. I don't know if they sat down and wrote out her skills and then made the show, or if they made her skills based on that, but really, really well done. Genuinely, really well done. She has her okie-dokie attitude, and she can handle whatever life throws at her, being leaving the vault, beheading a corpse, or realizing that everything she's ever been told has been an absolute fucking lie. Because of her naivete, because of her genuine belief that she's doing the right thing, she believes that Reclamation Day is a true thing that she is supposed to uphold. When she finds Shady Sands and she sees that there over 35,000 people used to live there, she's a little disheartened because that was her job, was to repopulate the surface. And what I think is a really, really interesting piece of lore that they gave her, a piece of character development, is that she believes in the Golden Rule. And I haven't heard of anyone genuinely bring up the Golden Rule since I was in probably the 3rd grade. And I don't know if this is an American concept, like just the term the Golden Rule is an American concept, or if it's like a... It's probably known across the world, but in different phrasing. The do unto others as you do unto yourself. She actually has a quote that I have written here. During episode 4, my favorite episode, when her and the ghoul are going at it, they're fighting, and the ghoul is pretty much saying to her, "You'll eventually turn into me." She goes, "I may end up looking like you, but I'll never be like you. Golden Rule, motherfucker." And... that's the first time, I think the first and only time she curses in the series. She says, "gosh damn it," which I don't really know if it counts or not, but I thought "gosh damn it" was really funny. I don't know if "gosh damn it" really is a curse, because I say "gosh damn it" because it makes me laugh, because you're just, you know. Oh, also, I want to talk about this while we're talking about Lucy. She has sex with that dude in the first episode. She's pregnant. Like, you're hearing it here. I'm gonna go over like each episode in just a moment, but like, she has sex with that dude, she's definitely pregnant. Like, that is going to be a huge plot point. Her friend Stephanie, that's from Vault 31, She even says, and that show, if that show does anything correctly, they talk about how her reproductive organs are in full tact, and then in episode 4 they're going to harvest her organs. The poster, and I believe episode 1 or episode 2, this is "Don't lose your head," and then she's cutting a dude's head off. Like, it does foreshadowing really well. Lucy McLean is pregnant with Monty's kid, and that's going to be a real story plot that we're probably going to see at the end of season 2, beginning of season 3, and I think it's a very interesting angle to take. Many believe that the vaults were used to repopulate, to save humanity, but if you're a Fallout fan, if you've only even watched the show, you may know that the vaults were never really intended for that. They were to experiment on people and get data on people, and eventually the Enclave were to go into space, colonize a planet. It's a whole fun thing, right? But I feel like we'd be remiss if I didn't talk a little bit about Lucy's family. Hank, her dad, Hank McLean, the overseer of Vault 33, her mom, Rose, who we don't really get to see all that much, Norm, her brother, Chet, her cousin, who she was sleeping with. She was having sex with her cousin. They have rules against that in the vault, but she was having sex with her cousin. We'll get to that in just a moment. Monty, her brief husband, who is a raider, who was living in Vault 32. And she has her friends. I really like Davey. I don't know if they're friendly, but the guy with the white mustache, big fan of Davey. I voted for Beth. In episode 1, you find out about who Lucy is. You get to see her wedding with Monty. You get to see everything that is important to her in her life. She says, and these are in her, some of these are direct quotes from her, she's an active contributor to the well-being of her community. She has repair skills. She's part of the Young Pipe Fitters Association. They unionized the vault. She has science skills, obviously nothing close to her father Hank, but always relishes a challenge. Her speech skills, her primary passions right before she gets married off, being teaching American history with a focus on ethics. Now, I want to just talk about this point in the show real quick. This is the only time we see kids in the vault, and it really bothers me because we never see them again. There was a raid that happens by raiders that inherited, took, usurped Vault 32, and then they come over to 33 and they try to do the same thing in 33. We see kids for a brief moment when you find out Lucy is a school teacher, and then never again. And then the kids never show up. Ever. Like, ever. I don't think they're even mentioned. And it bothers me that we, like, it's a little bit more background on Lucy. She's part of the gymnastic club, fencing team C, intermediate physical education, and dabbles a tad in riflery, even though, by her own admission, she says, although I am not very good, she loves taking walks, watching movies with her father, gardening again with Hank, her dad, her family book club, and all of her reproductives are intact, and she maintains her hygienic stance when it comes to interactions with the other. This is the only thing that ever took me out of the series when I was watching it. She said that she was unable to find a suitable marriage partner. Have you seen this girl? She's beautiful. But hey, it's fiction. We have to suspend our disbelief. Other than not being able to find a person to marry, she did have a 10-year relationship with her cousin Chet. It was only sexual, because they have strict rules against that down there. Which I think is really funny that that's brought up in the first, like, 15 minutes of the show. Because, I mean, what else would have happened? You know what I'm saying? Like, people would have been getting freaky, getting busy, getting nasty, getting dirty. Even Captain Lennox in the chat just points out, there's a super high chance that everybody down there is related. The only thing really keeping the gene pool from stagnating is probably Vault 31, which we'll talk a little bit about later. So like I said, that's the introduction to Lucy in episode 1, but a little bit more about episode 1, it's her wedding. And in that episode, you really see Lucy excited for what the future holds. She's probably been told since a little girl that you're supposed to breed. You breed and then you give to the surface. When it is time, we carry on humanity. So then when we leave, we can continue on. And it's 219 years later. She has no idea that many other vaults have opened. She has no idea. That should be in a game. A vault that's never opened that you open. And then you have to deal with the consequences of opening the vault. Like, you open it, and then, like, you leave and come back, and everybody's sick. And they're like, what the fuck is this? We got rid of the flu, and now it's here. She doesn't know that the world above them is functioning. She doesn't know that it's a thing. So as the doors to 32 open for 33, they do their human exchange. They say that they're going to give them some supplies because they had a great famine. The dwellers of 32 come over to 33. They have a big party. They have a wedding. Lucy is officially wed. She's officially a taken woman. And then the camera slowly shows you that everybody there is a raider. And that they just start attacking once Lucy and Monty, her now husband, go to consummate the marriage. The raiders attack. And during this attack, they kill everybody. Well, not everybody. They kill a large majority of people. And again, kids nowhere to be seen. And then Lucy is attacked by Monty after he gets a little sum. And then she winds up attacking him, cutting his face open. She runs out. She got stabbed in the belly. She stimpaks herself. She runs out. And we see, like, the dopest scene in the entire show. Like, honestly, they hit us with it really quick. A raider shoves a gun in a dweller's mouth and, like, shoots the back of his head out and then moves the body and shoots a bunch of other dwellers. It's super dope. It's really cool. If you see no other clips from this show, go watch that one because it rips. It's almost as cool as the time Rick Grimes bit a dude's neck out. Anyway, this all happens. Monty shows back up with a huge gash on his face. And Lucy hides her brother Norm away. And Hank kills Monty. He drowns him in a pickle barrel, like a barrel in which they use to make pickles. And I watched an interview with the fellow who plays Hank and the lady who plays Lucy, and they said that that dude smelled like pickles for like a week. Hank is then kidnapped by Moldover. They blow up part of the vault so they can't get into it, which Norm later will achieve access into, and then Lucy goes, well, I have to go and rescue my father because it's a modern Fallout game, so parental findings. We have to go find our parental figure. What else would we do in the wasteland? In episode 2, we get to see Lucy really experience what the real world is, what non-vault living is like, and there's a lot of great little character moments, the way she tries to talk to the ghoul and say, like, hey man, maybe don't shoot people's feet off. But she witnesses this, she sees Viltzig, and she goes, well, I have to help him. He can help me get to the other person, and the other person's other person. And she finds out that Moldover wants Viltzig, and she goes, cool, I will help this man get to where he needs to be. And by the end of episode 2, she's cutting off the deceased Viltzig's head. He's bleeding, he can't go on much longer. He takes Vault-Tec's Plan D, which just so happens to be cyanide, and he's off to Sleepyburg. And then he's like, please, you have to cut my head off and get it to Moldover. And he's like, she's like, okay, okie dokie. And then she chops a man's head off and he's already dead. In episode 3, we get to see a little bit more about who Lucy is and what kind of a genuine, gentle spirit she is. She sees a baby deer, a little fawn, and she wants to feed it. And as we see her trying to interact with the world, this is what she was told the world looked like before the bombs dropped. A gulper just shows up with finger mouth and tries to gulp her down, and it winds up getting the head, and then the ghoul shows up, points a gun at her, and sees, oh, you lost the head, the gulper has it, and he keeps dunking her in the water like bait, and he, like, gives this whole cool speech, and he's like, you know, I'm not here to torture you, I'm using you as bait, I have big teeth, and then they lose the head, and they have to go do other stuff, because the fight between the gulper, the ghoul, and Lucy being there, the ghoul's anti-feral medication smashes, and he needs some in a big bad way. So he takes Lucy as his prisoner and walks her to the Super Duper Mart, where he knows he can get the anti-feral meds. During my favorite episode, The Ghouls, Lucy is being taken to the Super Duper Mart by the ghoul, and she tries to break away, and when the ghoul tackles her and tries to get back at her, she bites his finger off, and he keeps his finger, but then when he catches up to her later on, he cuts her finger off, taking her to the Super Duper Mart, When she's brought to the Super Duper Mart, he offers her for 2 months worth of medication, and she's booted on into the Super Duper Mart, where Snip Snip, a Mr. Handy, is about to harvest her organs. She thinks she's about to become a sex slave. She doesn't think her organs are about to be harvested. But that's where she sees a bunch of ghouls. There's one whose name is Martha, who's a character that I love, even though she's on screen for next to no time whatsoever, who is slowly turning feral, trying to not go feral by saying, "My name is Martha." In this exact same episode, Lucy sees this happen to a fella named Roger, who knows the ghoul from either pre-war or maybe just as a ghoul. While she's in there, in the Super Duper Mart, she gets the one-up on Snip Snip, but Snip Snip also, reattaches a finger, just a finger, not her finger. He had a drawer of fingers and reattaches the fingers to her hand. So now Lucy just has a different hand, or excuse me, a different finger. Snip Snip goes to cut out her organs after Huey and Squirrel, the two chem fiends that are just watching cartoons and getting high in the Super Duper Mart, tell Snip Snip, yeah, go ahead and take her organs out. She gets free of that and brings over Snip Snip, the Mr. Handy that has been defibrillated, and he's short-circuiting, trying to get the upper hand now on Huey and Squirrel, and she demands that all of the ghouls get sent free. So they send the non-ferals out, and she goes, no, all of the ghouls. I want them all out. They let the ferals out, and the one Martha starts to twitch out and go feral and goes to attack Lucy. And this is where Lucy gets her first kill. This is the first time Lucy, essentially her Breaking Bad moment. This is the point where Walter White becomes Heisenberg. This is when she loses a large dose of her innocence and kills her with a 10 millimeter pistol. She then goes out to the ghoul who is outside, gives him the meds that he needs, and says to him, the quote that I said earlier, "I may end up looking like you, but I'll never be like you. Golden rule, motherfucker." In the next episode, which has one of my favorite scenes in it, Lucy comes across Maximus, who is stuck in the power armor after Thaddeus takes off with the head of Viltzig. They wound up getting it when they fight the Gulper. And they decide that they're going to work together. She has radiation sickness from the ghoul forcing her to drink irradiated water, and he helps her, hooking her up to a Rataway, and they become buddies in this sense. They become friendly. They decide to work together, and Maximus just lies to her and says that his name is Titus, but also he leaves the power armor behind for just anybody to find. And in one of my favorite scenes, just as they're crossing a bridge, they see these fiends. And they're trying to get past the fiends on the bridge. And by getting past the fiends on the bridge, Lucy says, "Why don't we just put our hands up on the count of three and we'll both walk by?" And the fiends see that Lucy has a Pip-Boy and some other equipment, and they go to shoot, and they're playing Ladyfingers. And that song rips. The Herb Alpert song, it smacks. It's so good. It's my favorite. It's probably one of my favorite scenes in the entire series thus far. And as they're walking across, you can see that one of them goes to shoot, and Maximus grabs Lucy's gun, and she refused to give it to him in the first place, and he takes the two of them out really, really quickly. And she, like, doesn't understand the world that they live in. This is the same episode where Lucy gets to see what happened to Shady Sands, and she gets to find out... She finds out about Shady Sands, but then we also get to find out that Maximus is originally from Shady, and how Shady didn't really work out in his mind. Now that they're injured in this process, they find a hospital and they go into it thinking we could find some medical supplies, and turns out there's a trap door that leads them to Vault 4. Now, while in Vault 4, Lucy's incredibly happy. She even says to Maximus when he comes to, he's like, "Where are we?" And she's like, "We're in the best place on the planet. We're in a vault." This is where we find out about Overseer Benjamin and how this vault's experiment was to take people in, and they would experiment on people that they were taking in. They meet Birdie, who I think might be Moldaver's daughter, because she holds the, you know, the whole flame mother cult ritual thing. Maximus gets treated for his wounds. He's given a suite to stay in, oysters, caviar. He's given television. He's given a robe, a hot shower, everything you could ever want. But Lucy sees the cult activity going on and decides this is not for her and that she needs to get out, especially because they're worshiping the person who kidnapped her father. Once she sees this cult activity going on, Lucy goes down to level 12, the level which they were told they were not allowed to go to. They were not allowed to see what it was, and it turns out that they were experimenting on humans, making the same gulpers that she was attacked by a few episodes ago. Maximus will go down to the fusion reactor, the cores, generators, and steal their fusion core that is down there because he needs it for his power armor. Turns out Vault 4 scavengers found his power armor and brought it down there so he can have access to it again. Lucy is captured for snooping around level 12 and is told that she is going to be... There's a ceremony about her that is about to happen. And she's like, I'm going to be put to death. And I'm watching that going, oh shit, they're really going to have to like fight their way out of this. Turns out they're just exiling her to death on the wasteland. And they give her 2 weeks worth of supplies. They give her food, Nuka-Colas, medical supplies. There's even a point where the overseer is like, yes, we'll have somebody walk it to you. Don't you worry. You don't have to carry it all the way up. But Maximus shows up and thinks that they're about to kill her, and he's in power armor, and he's just he punches a dude, like, in the ribcage, and the dude flies, like, 45 feet. And he's like, you might want to check that guy. He might be internally bleeding. Once they leave the vault, she convinces Maximus to give the fusion core back. She says that if she found out that she was implicit in a vault being completely destroyed... So she could go get her dad would be pissed. So they throw the fusion core back down the same trap door that they fell through, and Lucy had put a tracking device up the nose of the head of Viltzig. Now Viltzig, she had met briefly in episode 1 as she was walking in the wastes, and she was holding his decapitated head and shoved a tracking device from her Pip-Boy up his nose, so she knows where it is, and they're tracking Thaddeus, the squire who was with, supposed to be Titus's or Maximus's replacement. Thaddeus now has the head, and they meet Fred Armisen as DJ Carl playing fiddle music, and he has his entire place trapped. Just completely trapped. Just booby traps everywhere. And they wound up finding him, and Thaddeus doesn't want to give the head up. Thaddeus doesn't want to give the head up because he wants to have the artifact. He wants to have the thing that's going to make him more than a squire. Maybe a knight, a paladin, a star paladin, a sentinel, something. Because he has this piece of pre-war tech that is in Viltzig's neck. And he won't give it up, and as he's trying to broker some sort of a deal, he steps back, triggers a trap, and an arrow goes through his neck, and then he goes, oh god, why aren't I dead yet? And then he pulls it out, and the hole just kind of heals in his neck, and Maximus makes a deal with Thaddeus, saying, if you give Lucy the head of Viltzig, I'll go back with the Brotherhood and I'll give them this decoy head and you'll be spared and then I'll figure it out. So he takes one of the dead bodies there and smashes its face in so they can't see who it actually is. And then he goes on a vertibird back to the Brotherhood, and Lucy takes the head off to the Griffith Observatory. At this point, sometime before that, Lucy and Maximus share a kiss. I don't think it's super necessary. I get what they're getting at. I'm not one for this type of thing in media. I don't really think it's necessary that characters, because one is male, the other is female, they have to have intercourse. There's actually a point in that in the previous episode that I totally didn't even bring up because I feel like it's so inconsequential that Lucy kind of sees sex as something just to do. It's just an activity as long as you're not reproducing, because she asks Maximus if they would like to fornicate together. Not super necessary in my opinion. I get what they're going for. Not my cup of tea. I also just don't like sexual shit in most of my media. And in the final episode, episode 8 of the series of Fallout on Amazon Prime, Lucy makes her way to the Griffith Observatory. And as she's entering, she tells them that she has the artifact for Maldover, but she wants to speak with Maldover. You actually get to see one of the ghouls that were at the Super Duper Mart there with her, at the Griffith Observatory, and he recognized her and goes, oh my god, that's her! It's her from the Super Duper Mart! And she goes in there and she gives this whole spiel to Maldover, and you can see that it looks over what is LA, what is the Boneyard, and you can see Hank McClane in a cell, and you can see Moldaver sitting at a table. There's some NCR citizens there, and there's a ghoul chained up to a chair sitting there. Now, she goes in there and she gives this speech going, you know, I thought about putting a grenade in the head and giving it to you and blowing it up, but here, just take the head. I want my dad. And Moldaver kind of gives her this spiel about how her dad is the reason why Shady Sands is no longer there. Lucy and Norm at some point had left the vaults, 33, her mom's from 32, but had left 33 at some point in time and taken the kids to Shady Sands. And this memory that they show you throughout the show of Lucy and her mom turns out that it was her at Shady Sands. Lucy had been at Shady Sands. She found out through something silly, like you could tell by the way the water was coming through the erosion through the rocks of the vault. They could tell that there might be people out there. And she goes and finds Shady Sands, and Hank is so jealous that he's not the one in charge of this, that he had nothing to do with this, that he nukes, completely glasses over Shady Sands. And Lucy is just finding out that everything she's been told is a lie, and that the ghoul that is sitting at the table with Moldaver is actually Rose, her mother, who she doesn't really have any memory of. At some point, Moldaver leaves to go join the fight downstairs with the NCR and the Brotherhood. And Maximus runs in, shoots the lock off of Hank's cage, gets him out, and will later steal a suit of power armor that waltzes its way in. After the suit of power armor comes in without the head and collapses over, Hank, once out of his cage, gets in the power armor, and Maximus tries to say some shit to him, and he punches him, and it knocks him out, and he falls over right there on the ground. Right? As this is going on, the ghoul walks in and shoots Hank right across the cheek. Just right here, right? Not like a Joker smile, but right across the cheek. And you find out, Lucy finds out, that the ghoul knows Hank pre-war. That he was kept alive somehow. And how Hank used to work for the ghoul's wife, getting her his coffee. And the ghoul goes, where's my family? And everything Lucy's been told is just, it's over. And before the Brotherhood could even get there, Hank runs off, and Lucy sees her mom and realizes that she has to kill her mom. It's the honorable thing to do. The same way that the ghoul killed Roger to make sure that he could be at peace. Here is Lucy's mom, who pretty much is completely feral at this point, and she kills her. The ghoul and Lucy go off in search of Hank, looking for him. It is later found out that Hank is actually on his way to Vegas, but Moldaver, profusely bleeding, comes and sits down in the chair, holds Rose, Lucy's mom's hand, and goes, we did it, as the final bits of the cold fusion that was inside Wiltzig's neck is activated at the Griffith Observatory. You see all of the boneyard light up. It finally has power. The whole point, the whole thing we were fighting for was the cold fusion. You find out it was cold effing fusion that was stored in a little pill in his neck. And it starts. And she grabs Rose's hand just as she dies, even though Rose is already dead. And she goes, we did it, Rose. We did it. And she slowly passes away. And I just want to say real quick, I'm pretty sure Rose cheated on Hank with Moldaver. That dude got cucked so hard that he glassed a city. I think that's super neat. And the Brotherhood comes back in and they praise Maximus because Moldaver is dead. The Brotherhood has taken control, presumably taking control of the Griffith Observatory, the Cold Fusion, and they just instantly call him Knight Maximus. That's about everything we have for this season up until right now for the lore on Lucy McLean, but I'd like to read some fun facts real quick. Lucy is the first character in the entire Fallout series to visibly be seen crying. This is according to the Fallout Wiki, Nukipedia, if you will, fallout.fandom.com, that she's just the first person to be seen crying. Everything else is just text saying crying. According, this one I want to read directly. According to Ella Parnell's talent agent, she was going to portray a character named Jean in the TV series. It is unclear if this is an error or if Jean was renamed Lucy. And if you remember, like 2 years ago, I did a pitch on the podcast that was my pitch for the Fallout show. And I believe it was about a girl named Jean who was plucky and pretty much Lucy, but she was a follower and lived in Vegas. Ella Parnell said that she played Fallout 4 to get an experience of what it is like to be in the vaults, to play the games, to be in the universe. She does actually play other games. She's a voice actor in Arcane. This is one that I never even thought of, and I love the original games, but Lucy being a female protagonist with two other male protagonists is similar to Natalia Dobroszkai, a Polish last name, from Fallout, Chestia? From Fallout 2, and Nadia from Fallout Brotherhood of Steel. In an interview with Refinery29, Ella Parnell specifically criticized notions that the series was being woke due to its focus on a female protagonist, saying the Fallout games are inherently political and that analyzing society and its different groups is part of the DNA of Fallout. Parnell said she loves seeing women in survival dramas and seeing the brutality of violence women are capable of when they're hungry and in survival mode. And it breaks that stereotype of the women having to be, of how they are portrayed in media. Commenting, "You're not in this together. Pretty picture that films originally depicted women as." I don't even know if I'm going to keep that in. I just wanted to read that because shut up. You're fucking dumb. Why would you think, I'm going to keep it in. Why would you think, like, how are you going to sit there and go, like, I love when people say keep politics out of my video games and then say New Vegas is their favorite game ever. A game that's literally about politics. I love Lucy. I do. Lucy's my favorite protagonist from a Fallout game. I like her better than the Vault Dweller. I like her better than the Courier. I like her better than the Lone Wanderer. I like her better than the Soul Survivor. But, like, I love her. I love the way she's naive and you're supposed to identify with that because you're supposed to see you in the character. I love Lucy McClane. This is a Lucy McClane stan account. I love her. And I hope you love her too, because that is this week's lore. Ladies and ghouls, how are you? I'm going to put the microphone in his Michael stand for the remainder of the program. I talked about it last week. I feel like I should talk about it again. If you're listening to these live as they get recorded, if you're part of the Patreon, I have said multiple times how tired I am. I doubt I left it in the final edit. And again, I want you guys to know it is okay to take breaks. I know you really don't need to hear this from me. It is a great time to be a Fallout fan. Go play a Fallout game. I know Marcus and Chad has been playing Fallout 4. He and I have been talking about it quite a bit. I have been playing Fallout 4. I do have a save of New Vegas. I would like to be able to stream again. I am so busy that it hurts me. I have so many irons in so many fires. I have so many ideas for so many things. And I just don't have the time to do them. Find the things that make you happy, right? That's what I always say. And I have found things that made me happy. I just don't have enough time to do them. I went to the Asian market the other day just so I could buy dumplings because they're my favorite food. I don't have much to say for the end of this episode. Thank you for being here. I love you very much. The intro music is by the one and only Shane Ivers. It's called Feather Duster. You can get a link to his music in the description below. There's also a link in the description to my Twitter, the show's Twitter, and Kyle's Twitter. Check out the Patreon. If you liked this episode, check out the Patreon. Thank you. I'm going to. I'm done with this. I'm going to go wash my face, sit on the couch, and go, and then go to bed. There's a link in the description to the Patreon, the Discord. I think you should join the Discord. There's also down there is the link to the Redbubble. Check out the Redbubble if you get a chance to support the show in a small monetary way. If you have to, it's not mandatory. It would just help out around these parts. I love you. I will talk to you next week. Yes, I will talk to you next week, and I will be seeing you guys very, very soon. Thank you for spending this time with me. Thank you for being you. I love you. Again, I'll see you. Bye, everybody.
Atomic Radio Hour Podcast. This has been a production made by your friends at Ghoulman Entertainment.